Next up, we have Manas, who is the Data Science and NLP Lead at Episource, which is a U.S. healthcare company. And today, you'll be talking about building a decentralized data collection platform for deep learning in healthcare as well.
Yep. Good morning. So before we start off, I just want to quickly introduce myself in addition to what she mentioned. So I've been working with machine learning and data science at Episource, and our major target has been to build automated platforms for medical charts. So you have a length of medical charts and you would want to analyze what content it has. So you would have to do a fair bit of machine learning as well as natural language processing to extract entities, and entities being lab tests, procedures, diseases, and then map them to the corresponding ICD codes. So in that effort, it has been a massive exercise, both from a point of view of data collection, as well as creating machine learning pipelines. And one of the major targets and challenges of creating machine learning in pipelines in healthcare is you have to abide by certain regulations. And how they add more complications and how we essentially worked around it is what this talk is going to be about. Okay. So this is the broad agenda. So we'll talk about the problems and challenges, and I'll take you through three architectures that we are using in production now, and how they're essentially allowing us to be HIPAA compliant as well as ensuring that our machine learning pipelines work efficiently. So this is the problem statement. So last year when I joined Episource and I was brought on board to lead their data science team, Episource was struggling with a fair amount of competitive market pressures. And these market pressures were more to do with the amount of people you had to hire to deliver certain projects. Now, the projects to resources, essentially the employee was a very linear relationship. So if you wanted to deliver more projects, you would have to have hire more people. And since this is a very linear relationship, the scalability then suffers massively. So what you would want to do is add augmented intelligence using machine learning and NLP and ensure that these things are taken care of. And of course, Episource, since it's in a healthcare risk management business, it becomes a lot more important for it to adhere to new ML and NLP based experience platforms and ensure that they are at the bleeding edge of the healthcare machine learning research. So when I was brought on board, I was told and I was given a very a clear directive that we have to build a scalable information extraction pipeline for healthcare documents. And that's what we started off with. Now, there were major three challenges with creating this machine learning pipeline. The first being that it has to be scalable. And the second being it has to be local. As it goes with any machine learning platform or any machine learning pipeline you create, there are three things. It can be good, fast, or cheap. And you cannot have all three of them. You can only choose two of them. So you can either have it cheap and good, but it won't be fast, and so on. So it's a triangle which you only have access to a couple of them. So that was a big major challenge while creating this platform. And of course, when we are talking about creating a platform at that scale, where you're processing not thousands or hundreds of documents, but we are processing millions of documents, you have to create an architecture which is useful for optimized machine learning as well as optimized training data collection. And anyone who has worked with healthcare will tell you that there is a big compliance issue when you're working with machine learning healthcare. Now, privacy is a big factor nowadays, whether you're working in finance or whether you're working in healthcare or anywhere. So privacy when you're using social networks or when your medical data is out there becomes a lot more important. And HIPAA is that rule which guides and has a list of compliance checklists that you have to take care of. Now, what it essentially talks about at the core of it is that you have to secure the data, both while it is in transit as well as rest. So while you're transferring the data or while you're storing the data, you have to secure it in your best possible manner. And that's what HIPAA compliance talks about. And the KPI for us was we have to minimize the cost of processing, both from the data cleaning, data pre-processing, and the data inference, the machine learning inference that is, to the bare minimum USD per chart cost as much as possible. And I'll talk about what that cost has been brought down to. So this was a philosophy when I started off for the team. So I think this is a philosophy which is true for majority of the machine learning teams out there. Okay, so we would want scalable, fault tolerance, cost effective, lean machine learning pipelines, and we would want immutable configuration. So I do not want to be giving excuses to my boss, okay, hey, it works on my machine, I don't know why it's not working on the cloud. So I don't want to give those kind of reasonings to my peers or to my superiors. And at the end of the day, I did not want a bunch of people who are very good at DevOps or very good at ML. So I wanted people who are mostly ML ops kind of a profile people. So who have a fair bit of understanding of machine learning, as well as they can deploy their own algorithms. Because if I create my own algorithms and allow someone else to deploy it, Chinese whispers essentially will dictate that by the time my machine learning pipeline is deployed, it has become something else to what I had devised in the earlier. So that's what I want to avoid in the first place. So anyone in my team is able to create algorithm as well as deploy it on their own. So now, why is HIPAA a roadblock for us? Now you may say, okay, HIPAA dictates certain security, it dictates that you undertake certain security measures in terms of securing ML pipelines. But the major reasons why HIPAA becomes a roadblock is, one, there are many machine learning as well as backend architectures that you now can't use. Okay, now for example, if you are working on AWS cloud, there are many AWS services which are not HIPAA compliant, which means that you can't use them. Now there are services like S3, there are services like AWS Lambda which are HIPAA compliant. AWS Lambda is not actually HIPAA compliant, so you have to make sure that you're launching it in your own private VPC to make it HIPAA compliant. But explicitly, it's not HIPAA compliant. And you can't have public IP for servers, which means that if I have to run my entire machine learning pipeline, monitoring it as well as ensuring to how to debug it becomes an issue. So I have to create a automated pipeline where all these logs as well as debugging and what information in the way they are processed becomes a lot more streamlined. And as I said, that data has to be secure, data privacy has to be at the utmost, and that was what's going to regulate our entire machine learning architecture. So that's when we decided to go serverless. So we said, okay, hey, there are three components to machine learning. One is the training data collection. Now, you would know, anyone who has worked in machine learning will tell you that no matter how complicated your algorithms are, if you don't have quality training data, doesn't matter. Okay, so you can have high quality training data with as something as simple as logistic regression. This is going to work very well. Unlike you have 10-layer deep neural networks based on PyTorch with very low quality training data. So the first target was to collect that data in the first place. And we being in healthcare, there is no public data available which is annotated, which says, okay, hey, this is a medical chart, these are the annotated diseases, these are the annotated lab tests, these are the annotated procedures. So in that case, what we had to do is, since we had, and that's why we like to call Episource as a machine learning heaven, because we have roughly more than 3,000 people, and our data science and NLP team can get access to anywhere from 50 to 200 people to create training data for 3 months at very short notice. So if you want to create training data, I could just call up the senior management who handles ops and ask them, okay, I want a certain amount of people deployed for a certain amount of time. But even then, they're going to be working on private healthcare data. They're going to be annotating private medical data. And so, which means that their entire architecture to even annotate that data as well as collect the training data has to be encrypted as well as HIPAA compliant. So we'll talk about a couple of methods of how we are doing. So, and while we are going serverless, there are multiple platforms like Docker, which allow us to create those immutable configurations. And anyone who has used Docker will also tell you that once it's you learn the basics of Docker, it's extremely easy to deploy and as well as use it in machine learning. And it's a very nifty tool when it comes to any amount of DevOps deployments. And these are our major kind of pillars. So we are using Docker, Ansible, Boto, which is a Python wrapper around AWS Cloud, and the AWS platform itself. And that's what we believe is, if I'm not maintaining my platform, if I'm not spending time maintaining my platform, which is essentially no ops, that's the best kind of DevOps. So I did not want my DevOps people to come in and just work on maintenance, but rather create a HIPAA compliant platform, which is self-healing as well as self-reliant. So here I'll take you through three architectures. So there are three architectures that I'm going to be showcasing. And one is the data collection architecture, where we are creating it in a serverless manner as well as ensuring that they're HIPAA compliant. The second part is the data processing. And the third part is the machine learning model deployments. So these are the three separate architectures that I'll basically be showing you as to how we are creating these machine learning platforms. So this is the broad overview. So how do I essentially make sure that my platform, my environments at the bare minimum are well maintained? So I use PyCharm as my IDE, preferred IDE. And since I have to use Python to create all my machine learning models and exclusively use PyTorch now. What I've done is I've created a Docker container as a remote interpreter for PyCharm. And every time I'm compiling a bunch of code, I'm testing this against this Docker container. And what happens is that my code base, my machine learning training, my pre-processing, as well as my prediction code bases are tested in real time. And all I have to do is I have to push this Docker image to AWS ECR. Now, AWS ECR is same as Docker Hub for private Docker images. And once I've done this, I essentially have lambdas triggering these architectures. And we are using services like AWS STS, which is the security token service, to generate temporary credentials. So we are not plugging in the core AWS security keys, but rather generating these keys on the fly. And at the end, when we are using Docker, we know that Docker can't be used for persistent tasks. So we can't use Docker where the persistent data becomes a lot more important. But we want to be using Docker where we want to save logs. We want to load our pickle files. So what we essentially do is we mount a encrypted disk from AWS EC2 services as the Docker volumes and ensure that the models as well as the logs are saved in real time, and then which are then pushed to S3 at the end of the run. So this is the first architecture that we are using to collect data. Now, so this is a kind of very skeleton framework of what we are doing. So obviously, we have like 300 people working on a platform like BRAT, which is a Stanford NLP annotator, open source annotator. So what we have done is we have created multiple images of BRAT on multiple servers. Now, the issue is that I am trying to create a three-level QA system, which means that the same chart has to be annotated by at least three coders before I finalize that as my training data, which also means that I cannot have three separate copies. I need to have the same copy on across servers. So for that, and since there are 300 people logging in, I don't want the site, the BRAT, to become slow. What I would do is I will place it in front of a load balancer. And there are three or four servers attached to my load balancer. But the content, the training data itself, is going to be pulled from something called the Elastic File System. Now, EFS is essentially, you can think of, has anyone worked with AWS before? Okay, so in AWS, there is the concept of you can attach your own disks, which is called EBS, and you can encrypt them on your own. Now, in a typical scenario, you would have to attach three separate EBSs to these three separate servers. But what that would mean that I have three separate copies, and these three copies are not synced. But my use case dictates that I need to sync my copies. So what EFS essentially is an advanced form of EBS, to put it simply, which you can attach to multiple servers. So you can think about it like it's a remote disk which you can mount across your machines. Okay, so if you make any change on your machine and it's a remote server, FTP server, it will reflect on someone else's machine as well. So EFS works in that manner, which means that anytime a person comes in and makes a change here, it gets automatically synced in EFS, which then automatically gets reflected across the server, and it's real time. And then once that is done, we have a Lambda job, which ensures that we take regular 6-hour backups of the CFS service. So what we have is we run Lambda jobs to take backups from the CFS into S3. And what this is also allows us is we have used this architecture, which is a relatively simplistic architecture, to even create chatbots. Now in healthcare, you have to collect two kinds of data. Now one, you have to collect the annotated data itself, where you have to say, okay, hey, this refers to this disease or this procedure. But you also have to collect taxonomies. Okay, so you have to collect data where you say diabetes mellitus also means diabetes. So while I would know that diabetes and diabetes mellitus are similar, the machine would not necessarily know unless and until I use techniques like cosine similarity, and even in that case it's going to fail. So I need to also create these taxonomies and ontologies on the fly. So for that, what we have done is we have created a simplistic chatbot which will collect these taxonomies. So we would have these questions asked to the person, okay, what is the nearest synonym of diabetes mellitus? And he is going to provide us a list of synonyms. And this is what is going to, then we are also going to have three-level QA. So we are not going to take the answer from only one person, but we are going to aggregate it from across people. So this is our kind of data collection kind of methodology, where and all these servers are in the private VPCs, private subnets. And the reason being is that we cannot have a public IP for a server with private healthcare data, which means that all this has to be in a private subnet. And this one, the load balancer itself, then routes request via the NAT gateways to the servers. So this is a slightly more complicated version of the data processing architecture. We have created two new components using this architecture. So the first part is how does the data processing pipeline start? Now we are provided lots of healthcare data. Now the healthcare data can be anywhere from 10,000 charts to even half a million charts. So what we do is we have a certain threshold is when the data is uploaded to S3, which is the storage buckets for AWS, we trigger a Lambda. So we have a threshold which says, okay, if the number of charts in a certain bucket are greater than X, in our case is typically anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000, then you start off a pipeline. So then there is a AWS Lambda, which is a function as a service for our AWS. And we use AWS Lambda to launch our architecture using Ansible. Now you may say, okay, why I'm not using AWS Lambda itself to do my complete processing? Because AWS Lambda puts two limitations on my entire processing pipelines. One is that the maximum RAM memory that I can have access to is only 1.5 GB, and it's a lot more expensive. So the minimum is 128 MB and the maximum is 1.5 GB. So I cannot have my machine learning pipeline operate in 1.5 GB. And the second and the most business critical limitation that it places on is that the execution time of one Lambda function cannot be more than 5 minutes. which means that I cannot use Lambda to create my entire machine learning pipeline end to end. So now what I do, just Lambda, using Lambda, I just create an architecture using Ansible. Now, if you are using Ansible, it essentially is a method by which you can run through a multiple level of stuff. So I like to look at Ansible like it's a cleaner form of bash scripting. So it's a YAML file where you can specify a list of steps, and that allows you to launch your architecture in the way that you would want. Now, I could also could have used services like Terraform or AWS CloudFormation, but Ansible looks a lot more readable, and it's a lot more easier to debug and a lot more easier to implement. And once this is done, then we launch the service. Now, there is a master-slave kind of architecture, so where the master itself is launched in the public subnets, and the slaves here are launched in the private subnets. Now, the task of the master essentially is to pull the tasks from a queue, which is the SQS queue of AWS, and provide them to the slaves. That's all it requires to be done. So, but now what we have moved on to is we have moved on from AWS Lambda to this master-slave architecture to Lambda to AMR clusters. So instead of launching a master-slave architecture in both public and private subnet, now we are doing this using AMR architectures. And then finally, once the data processing is done, it's saved on S3. Now, we could always have saved it in a database. Now, we could always save our data processing outputs in a database. Now, but what that provides, while that provides a good amount of flexibility to us, to go out and share it with others as well. But what it doesn't take care of is the cost. Now, if you're saving the data on something like DynamoDB, the costs are very prohibitive. And the maximum amount of data that you can save in, say, DynamoDB is something around 64 KBs per item. And since if it's a longer chart, I am never going to have data worth of 64 KBs. It's going to be more than 1 MB at the bare minimum. So I can't save it in DynamoDB or any database for that matter. So what we have done is we have created a serverless database API where we are saying that we have created an API endpoint with its own resources in a RESTful manner. We save the data itself in as JSONs in S3. And once you hit this API endpoint, it triggers a Lambda. And this Lambda then goes ahead and fetches the data from S3. And it fetches the JSON and returns the data as a JSON format. Okay, and while the response time is not that great, it's not in seconds, but it's somewhere around 100 to 200 milliseconds. But at the end of the day, we don't require real-time updates, or we don't require real-time response anyway. So what that does is it allows me to create my own API endpoint in my own scalable manner. So I can say, okay, in this chart, how many diseases were there? In this chart, how many procedures with body parts were mentioned? So was there leg X-ray mentioned, or was there only X-ray mentioned? So I can create my own custom API endpoints and using this API. So what this essentially is, we have created is a serverless S3-based database. It's not a database, but is more of a pseudo database, as we put it inside our team. So, but if you're working with any kind of places where you have larger documents that you have to store and analyze, it's preferable that you also use this method. So you store it in S3, you have a Lambda in the middle, and you back it with the API gateway and create your own APIs with that. And the final architecture is how we deploy our models. So we need to save our models in a S3 bucket, for example. Now, this model has to be either a place where we understand whether or not our models has improved, or whether or not we have been able to create a proper environment for this model to be deployed in the first place. So what we do is every time there is new data in our S3 bucket, which is the annotated data, which is coming from the first architecture, So every time we have three-level QA performed and the data is saved into S3, we again trigger a Lambda and Ansible-based architecture. And what that does is every time either there is a new data in S3 or there is new code pushed into our GitHub master. So we have a separate GitHub repo where we push our data processing and training pipeline code. And every time there is a new code pushed after obviously the relevant tests in the master branch, there's a Lambda which is triggered. So now this Lambda can be triggered by only two methods, either new data or updated code. And once that's done, we start training the model using our GPUs on the AWS. And what we have is, in a certain place, we have the runs for the last few weeks saved. So we know what was our previous best. So every time my new model and new data comes in, I need to see it automatically whether I have improved from my earlier performance. And if I have, what I then essentially do is I remove previous one and previous model from the Docker image and re-upload and rebuild my Docker image. So that's what we essentially do. So all this is automated. So no one essentially takes care of this aspect. So no one looks or debugs into that. All we know is when was this model run, what was the precision, what was the recall, what was the F score, and what was the accuracy. And we typically monitor recall. So if the recall is better, the current recall is better than the previous recall, then we deploy the new model. And that's how this architecture runs. So in all these three architectures, the one common underlying point for us is no one is monitoring it. And that itself is kind of a big challenge. But with this, what we have been able to do is that the processing cost, either machine learning inference or the data processing cost itself, for us is extremely low. So we can process 1 million documents at roughly $500. And that brings us as to a very low cost per chart kind of rate. And of course, all of these architectures are HIPAA compliant, which means that I've created an architecture which processes lots of documents in a lot scalable fashion, but also is not breaking the bank. To put this in perspective, if I would have processed 1 million documents with having servers 24/7, as well as proper sysadmins and monitoring platforms, then this one would have been roughly around $25,000. And this I'm talking about just for 1 month. So if I'm processing 1 million charts per month, then with all the servers and all the costs that I have, would have been roughly around $25,000. But with these three architectures that I currently showed you, which is pure serverless as well as requires very limited monitoring, the cost comes down to $500, which is a lot less and a lot effective when you are trying to create a scalable machine learning platform. And of course, there are their own challenges when it comes to creating your own serverless backend. Now, there are two major questions that everyone will ask. So what do you do if something fails? Do you know if something fails, how do you monitor? Because one, you're going to be launching everything in private VPCs, which means that you don't necessarily know what failed unless until you log into that server. And how do you monitor each step? Because in each of these architectures which I showed, there are multiple moving parts. So there is a launching of the architecture, there is the pulling of data from S3, there is deploying the code and pulling the Docker image from S3, and there are multiple such steps. Now, how do you monitor each step? Now, these are the two challenges that come with a lower cost but scalable architecture. So what we have done is...
I think, in the purposes of time, I
just have a couple of slides.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. So, so what we have essentially done is we have decoupled our tasks. So we are using SQS queues to decouple our tasks and to set up lambdas to see if these tasks, are there any pending tasks that are there, and reinitiate those tasks. And of course, there are dead letter queues which would reinitiate the processing after some tries. And then finally, we use CloudWatch metrics to monitor our complete pipeline. And we have automated these using Slack. So every time some task fails or succeeds, there's a alert sent to Slack and emails to all the stakeholders. And I think that's it. Thank you all.
Thank you, Manas. So, yeah. Unfortunately, we've run out of time for questions, but I'm sure you can take